My name is Callie Durr. I'm an attorney at Colorado Legal Services. This video provides information regarding rights of parents and Colorado's best interest of the child factors. The right to parent comes from, amongst other places, Troxell v. Granville, which was a case decided at the United States Supreme Court in the year 2000. To summarize, the Supreme Court in Troxell stated that the relationship between parent and child is protected by the United States Constitution, that the United States Supreme Court has recognized the fundamental right of parents to make decisions concerning the care, custody, and control of their children, and so long as a parent adequately cares for his or her children, i.e. is fit, there normally will be no reason for the state to inject itself into the private realm of the family or to further question the ability of a parent to make the best decisions concerning the rearing of the parent's children. Essentially, Troxell presumes that a child's parents are fit to parent and will make decisions for the child that are in the child's best interest. This also means a court cannot interfere with the ability of parents to care for or make decisions for minor children unless doing so is in a minor child's best interest. So, in Colorado, parenting time and decision-making must always be in the best interest of the children, which is determined by reviewing the best interest of the child factors as stated in Colorado Revised Statutes 1410-124. The remainder of this video will be spent discussing the best interest of the child factors the court considers when entering orders regarding parenting time and decision-making. Please see the videos regarding allocation of parental responsibilities basics and parenting plans for more information regarding allocation of parenting time and decision-making responsibilities. As a reminder, court orders regarding allocation of decision-making responsibilities are based on the best interest of the child factors as stated in Colorado Revised Statutes 1410-124. The first factor the court should consider when it's entering orders regarding decision-making responsibilities is whether one or both parents have perpetrated child abuse, neglect, or domestic violence. This has to be proven by the preponderance of the evidence. Preponderance of the evidence means that the court must believe it is more likely than not that child abuse, neglect, or domestic violence has been perpetrated by one of the parties. Even if child abuse, neglect, or domestic violence is proven by the preponderance of the evidence, the court can order joint decision-making if it finds credible evidence of the party's ability to make decisions cooperatively despite the child abuse, neglect, or domestic violence that has occurred. The court also should consider the party's past pattern of involvement with the child and whether mutual decision-making will promote contact between one of the parents and the child. The past pattern of involvement generally means the court must consider who has made major decisions for the child throughout the child's life and who has made these decisions since the party's separation. In determining whether mutual decision-making will promote contact between the child and the parent, the court will often consider whether one parent has been left out of decision-making through no fault of their own, amongst other considerations. The court also has to consider the best interest of the child factors, again, as stated in Colorado Revised Statutes 1410-124, when it enters orders regarding parenting time. I'm going to go through those best interest of the child factors and give a little bit of an example for each one. The first factor is the wishes of the child's parents. So what does each parent want for parenting time and why do they want it? For example, it might not be okay for a parent to request parenting time or a parenting time order to punish one parent or to continue to exert control in domestic violence situations. So again, the parents shouldn't be trying to punish each other with the parenting time order they're requesting, and they shouldn't be trying to continue to exert that control when they're requesting parenting time. So again, that is for wishes of the child's parent. The next factor is for the wishes of the child. The wishes of the child may be given weight in court and they may not be. So the weight given to the wishes of the child depends on the child's maturity. So this is not always about age, but it's about maturity and why the child is wishing for one parenting plan over another. For example, if a 16-year-old is wanting more parenting time at mom's house because mom travels a lot and leaves a 16-year-old home alone where she can have friends over, that's not a good example of a child having a mature reason for requesting a particular parenting plan. If that same 16-year-old said she felt safer at mom's house than dad's, then that might be a situation where the child's wishes are taken into consideration because it's a mature rationale for those child's wishes. The next factor is the relationship between the child, parents, siblings, and others. So these are the people the child spends time with, the activities they partake in, whether the child gets along with others in the family's extended circle. Who does the child confide in? Who does the child look to for comfort? Are there any half or step siblings in either parent's home? For example, dad has a mean roommate who yells at the children, and the children don't want to be around that roommate. So that's going to be a consideration the court takes when it enters parenting time orders. The next factor is the child's adjustment to their home, school, and community. So this factor requires the court to consider the parent the child is more emotionally close to, the age of the child and how long they've lived at their current home, the physical layout and condition of each party's home, whether the child will have to change schools if parenting time is awarded to one parent, whether the child is engaged in activities, who they hang out with in their neighborhood, who they see in terms of family members, etc. So for example, if the child is well adjusted to their school, they're doing really well in school, but a changed parenting plan would force that child to change school districts, the court might think twice before forcing the child again to change school districts or change schools if they are successful in their current school. The next factor the court will consider is the physical and mental health of all individuals involved. So this isn't necessarily about, minor medical conditions, but it's about bigger untreated issues normally. Maybe dad is depressed, he's not in treatment, and he can't get out of bed on certain days, so he cannot care for the children. That's going to be a factor the court considers strongly. The next factor is the past pattern of involvement with the child. It is similar to the past pattern of involvement factor we're looking at for decision-making, but slightly different since we are dealing with parenting time. So this asks, who is the child's primary caretaker? Who chose the child's doctor? Who obtained health insurance for the child? Who cares for the child when they're sick? Who attends parent-teacher conferences? Who puts the child to bed? Who cooks for the child? Who disciplines the child? Who comforts the child when they're sad or scared, etc. There's a lot of different questions that can come up with the past pattern of involvement with the child. But again, it's asking primarily who has been the child's caretaker. Also the court is going to want to know who has played these roles for the child since the child was born, who has played the roles for the child pre-separation, before the party separated, and who has been performing these roles for the child since the party separated. Next, the court is going to consider the physical proximity of the parties. So this is really about practicality, because if parents live in different states, different cities, different neighborhoods, those are all things that the court needs to consider when it's putting a parenting time schedule in place. Do the parents live in the same neighborhood? Do they live in different school districts, same city, same state? And this is going to, again, make the court consider, will the child be unable to walk or ride their bike to spend time with their friends when they're at the other parent's house? Will the child have to change schools if the primary parent is changed? Will the child have to travel long distances by car or by plane for parenting time with the other parent? Who's going to pay for those car trips or plane rides? So again, this is really about the practical considerations if the parties live separately from each other and depending on how far away they live from each other. The next factor the court will consider is the ability of the parties to place the needs of the child over their own needs. So this factor can include a lot of things, and it's going to be pretty strongly considered by the court in a lot of cases. It's really easiest just to explain this factor by giving a couple of examples. So for example, maybe father refuses to reorganize his work schedule to accommodate parenting time with the child. The court might see that as father prioritizing his work over the child. So again, his own needs, his career, money, things like that, which of course are important, but he's putting that over the needs of the child, which are to spend time with their father. Another example is maybe mother will not allow father to see the child on the child's birthday, when that birthday has fallen on mother's parenting time. And maybe the mother is not allowing father to see the child on the child's birthday, even though the child has requested to see father and mother on their birthday, and there's no safety concerns that mother has about father. So this could be something where the court sees a mother putting her need to maybe continue to punish father for things that happened in the relationship that didn't include the child over, again, the child's need and desire to see their father on their birthday. The last and possibly one of the most important factors that the court is going to consider is whether, again, child abuse, neglect, domestic violence, or sexual assault leading to the conception of the child is present. If these situations are proven by preponderance of the evidence, similar to when they're proven in decision making, the court can put certain conditions on parenting time in order to ensure the safety of the child and the abused party. Some of these conditions on parenting time can include supervised parenting time for the perpetrating parent, no overnight parenting time, keeping the abused party and/or, of course, the child's address confidential, limiting contact between the parents by ordering them to only communicate via talking parents or email and text, only allowing exchanges of the child in protected settings like police stations, at CASA, or at a grocery store, and any other orders necessary to keep the child and the abused party safe. So again, that's going to be an important factor if there was child abuse, neglect, domestic violence, or sexual assault resulting in the conception of the child. Those are going to be important things to try and prove in order to keep maybe yourself and the child safe. Evidence must be presented to the court regarding why your proposals for parenting time and decision-making are in the best interest of your child. Please see the video regarding presenting your case in court for more information regarding presenting evidence. That concludes this video regarding, again, the rights of parent and the rights of parents and the best interest of the child factors in Colorado. I hope this was helpful and have a great rest of your day.